Welcome back to the LIGO India podcast, listening to the cosmos. And you won't believe who we have in our virtual studio today with us. It's Karan Jani. So many of you have already requested Karan to be present here on the LIGO India podcast. And today we are going to have an amazing conversation. We are going to find out all about his inspiration, his life, his work, and more. So let's find out from Karan himself. So Karan is a well-known Indian astrophysicist working with LIGO. He has also been featured in the Forbes 30 Under 30. And he was even part of the LIGO team, which led to the first observation of gravitational waves from binary black hole mergers. So Karan, a warm welcome to the LIGO India podcast. This is Debarati. I'm associate professor at IUCA and also chairperson of the LIGO India Education and Public Outreach.
Well, thank you so much, Professor Debarati, for having me. It's a true honor to be here and on LIGO India's official podcast. Thank you.
This is a pleasure for us as well to have you with us. So, Karan, I'm sure as soon as we say India, you're going to be nostalgic. So tell us something about your background, about your childhood. Where were you born? Where did you grow up?
Yeah, I grew up in Vadodara. Those who don't know, it's a town within Gujarat. And I grew up in a very quite quintessential Gujarati household, in the sense that there was nobody doing science. We didn't really know. I didn't meet anyone in flesh and blood ever until I eventually joined physics. I never met anyone in scientist. So there was not any per se childhood training that I had. I just grew up without having any pressure from the parents. I think that was my plus point.
This is really interesting. So I think naturally the next question that comes to my mind is, what was your inspiration, like personal or professional, to become a gravitational wave scientist?
I think the gravitational wave part came much later, albeit not as late. After I finished high school, and until like 10th board is done, you're like, when I join, what's the next thing? It's like either you do commerce or you do science, and that's how it is. And naturally the expectation is, you join science if you have scored beyond some false alarm rate in 10th exams. So I joined sciences, and then after science, while you're in 12th, all this entrance test thing pops up. And I was just terrible at it. I knew I didn't want to do, I hated solving physics questions in a limited time. And I still hate it. And I still think that's neither a way to learn physics or not anything in sciences. So as a matter of principle, I said to my parents, I'm never going to give any entrance test. So after 12th, I had, there was no other colleges to apply, except based on my 12th score, I joined BSc in physics. And that's how at least I started my formal training in physics.
I'm sure a lot of science students right now will be very motivated by this, whatever you said. So great. So I think let's find out a little bit more from you about your academic journey. So after finishing your studies in Baroda, where you went to Penn State, right?
I transferred halfway. I had finished my first year, and I was just genuinely curious about, I want to be a physicist. And when you ask the third year students what your plan is, and everyone is like, we are going to give CAT and we're going to go apply for MBA schools. And I was like, that was the whole point of not for me not taking sciences, because not going to commerce, because I didn't want to do any of that. I clearly remember that when, after board exams, we have this, you go to a center and tells you, you have this seat available based on your 12th mark sheet, this, that.
Right.
And I told my parents that I don't want to do any form of engineering. I don't mind doing BSc. And I think there was a bit stigma, you know, in India, at least it's lesser there, thankfully, you know, because of things like LIGO India being known to people, you know, all the other missions, ISRO missions, etc. But at least back then, when you say someone that you are doing BSc, they already judge you, or you did not score so much in 12th. That's why only you will be going to BSc.
Right.
And it's a very sort of this constant thing on you, right, all the time, that you are not doing something worthwhile. And I think that partially was the reason why everyone who was doing physics, majority of them would try to give GAT exam and, you know, go to the MBA circle, etc. So I realized that it was just going to be, I'd be more lost if I stayed. It was very weird. I started, you know, back then it was the cyber cafe days. You may remember those days.
Yeah, sure.
So you go and, I open, like, you know, what are the astrophysics programs? And I started emailing them. And I started randomly emailing, you know, many, many universities across the globe. And some responded, and that's how I ended up going to Penn State.
Wow. So you interestingly did, you completed a couple of undergraduate degrees, is that correct?
I did my half bachelor's here, but then I went to Penn State. I did one major in physics, I did another major in astronomy, astrophysics, and I did a minor in mathematics at the time.
That's interesting. And then you also had some visiting positions in MPIG and Perimeter, if I'm correct?
Yes, I was at the Potsdam, Albert Einstein Institute, the Max Planck. That time I was I had just finished my second year of undergraduate.
Right.
I was visiting one of the Indian scientists there, Badri Krishnan.
Oh, I know him. I also visited Potsdam back then. Okay.
Yeah. And, the year after, I was at the Perimeter Institute in the quantum gravity group there of Lee Smolin.
Okay. And then you did your PhD in physics from Georgia Institute of Technology. And I know that your PhD work involved creating the largest public catalog of numerical relativity simulations of binary black hole. Is that right?
That's, yes, part one of that thesis, yes.
Okay.
So I was just started my PhD when the group joined LIGO. And one of the things that came with us joining LIGO is I started the search for intermediate mass black holes.
Right.
And so my half thesis was in numerical relativity, and half thesis was doing the burst search for intermediate mass black holes. And none of us had, of course, predicted that the first gravitational wave discovery would also happen. And so whatever, you know, things that followed up, everyone left everything in the world they were doing and just started working on the discovery at the time.
Right.
And so did I. And third part of the thesis work on that. And so my thesis, it was interesting because I had to write it in like the separate parts.
So currently you are a research faculty at Vanderbilt University. And your research still involves building data analysis tools, right, for intermediate mass black holes. I know that you are also involved in many other projects. So let me ask you about them. So I know that you are also developing some tools for joint observations of black holes between LIGO and the upcoming LISA mission, right? So do you want to tell us something more about this?
Yeah. So my first formal project in gravitational wave was with the LISA mission. And throughout my 4 years of undergrad, I worked with Professor Lee Samfin. He was one of the pioneers of gravitational wave astronomy, and particularly gravitational wave data analysis. And Sam's group was involved with both LIGO and LISA mission. And LISA at that time was still pretty much, you know, considered like late 2010s, you know, LISA would fly. And in the decade of 2010, LISA mission got scrapped from NASA. And after that, it was only going to be a European mission. So I wanted to continue my PhD in LISA, because at the time we had this sort of snobbish thing, oh, LIGO is not going to detect gravitational wave. You need a space to find it.
Right.
And a lot of LIGO work at the time involved detector characterization, numerical relativity simulations, and coming from this the school of thought that physics has to be this elegant phenomena and not this kind of software engineering. It took me a lot more maturity later on to realize that this is really how physics is. The modern physics is computational. It is understanding how experiment, how detector works. And that is more fundamental than what are the actual sources that create gravitational waves, at least in terms of our pursuit and our ability to detect them. So I was working on LISA mission, and then LISA got scrapped, caught in LIGO. And then it just happened. So I came here at Vanderbilt, particularly because our group leader, Professor Kelly Holly Bockelman, she is the NASA's chair for the LISA study team from the US side. And so she is heavily involved with the LISA mission. And it just was a sort of a natural continuation that the next gravitational wave experiment is LISA. So, being here now, thinking about what I feel is this something very similar that a lot of people in 2010s were thinking about LIGO would make the first detection. And I think it's the same time we are now to ask the question what we can see with LISA.
Tell us something about the excitement that was happening around the first detection of gravitational waves from binary black hole mergers, and also the recent first detection of intermediate mass black holes.
Yes. The first detection, it still gives you a sort of goosebumps, right? And you remember seeing the first time frequency map of the first detection. And then you see the reconstructed signal of gravitational wave from the burst search it was at the time.
Okay.
And very basic, I think that was within 24 hours of the first seeing the signal. And it was the start of O1 had just started that very day. So the Friday before, so discovery happened on Monday. And on the Friday, took a weekend vacation with my friends, saying that, oh, this is going to be, long 6-7 months. And so let's take a break. And on Friday, I presented at the LIGO call and saying that, look, if we had any signal from 50 to 200 solar mass, this is whatever the sensitivity is, etc. And Monday, then the signal pops up. So looking at the time frequency map and constructed waveform, so the first thing was just take a equal mass, non-spinning numerical relativity waveform and try to just fit it. And that's itself, you knew that, well, wow, this has to be somewhere close to, the mass that most had not expected. In fact, I had a very interesting conversation with someone very senior. I'm not going to name that person because of high respect that I have for him. But he had, when I started, he had said that, doing intermediate mass black hole search is not going to be very fruitful because, years of X-ray astronomy has already told us, that the black hole masses are close to 10. And, if we had evidences of black holes about 30, 40 solar masses, let alone them being close to 90 to 100, we would have seen that in X-ray astronomy. And I was a bit sort of hesitant, like, wow, one of the founding leaders of the field is saying this. And I think the two discoveries that you mentioned, the first discovery and the intermediate mass black holes, is a testimony of how much we genuinely don't understand the universe. It's not that, it's not really that, everyone had a very clear insight based on decades of astronomical observations. And that is true with a lot of things. When you look at the most massive neutron star, whether you look at the most massive black holes, the black holes in the pairs that we find, this is all things that are, there is no one, other than saying that, well, there is some exotic phenomena, we didn't know how common the universe could have made it. So that has been in singularly my experience, and my love for gravitational wave astronomy is that we are clearly looking at a universe with a very fresh perspective, per se to speak. Like, this is of the first generation of scientists that is really getting to see the universe this way. And every mission keeps adding that.
Yes. We are born in such exciting times. Like, it's opening up new surprises every day. So nice to hear about this. Like, almost sounds like the script of a Hollywood movie.
Yeah, the intermediate Mars black hole discovery was almost... it was two... I mean, there are a few parts, you know, where I remember when the first discovery happened and I could not tell anyone, right, you know, that we are part of a gravitational discovery. And the December before, we announced in February, in December, I was in India. And my parents, and I've been away from home for a while, a couple of 6-7 years by then. And they never had much understanding of what I do. I mean, they ask and they say, oh, you know, I study astrophysics, I study black holes. And they're like, that was it. You know, that was not for them a need to know more. And I said, you know, maybe in February, you know, you'll hear something very interesting that I've been working on quite a lot. And lo and behold, and it was very surprising, the Gujarati newspapers, right? I mean, not even the English Times of India, like Gujarati newspaper had that as a headline on February. And somehow they found this tiny picture of mine from somewhere, like my 10-year-old photograph that I know I never want anyone to see. I think that it's the ability that now people understand what gravitational waves is. It's not like finding water on Mars, right? This is a much complex, nuanced phenomena. This is space-time with 4-dimensional universe releasing perturbations in space-time created by black holes, which are something so difficult, every concept. And yet people in different languages in India are able to read and comprehend. I think that is the singular biggest excitement I have about being part of the discoveries.
Right. Your parents must be so proud of you, huh? So that brings me to your awards and recognitions. I know that you have been featured and honored with many of them. You were featured in the Forbes 30 Under 30 for your contribution to numerical relativity. You were also postdoc of the year by Vanderbilt University, right? CNN News 18 Tech Personality of the Year. You have given invited talks at official TED conferences. And you have also been at the advisory positions at several educational institutions in India. So, I mean, do you want to tell us something about these experiences, honors?
I mean, it's always, it gives the impetus to do more, but I think more than that, the every non-academic honor gives the chance to speak with a completely different audience, part of the society, and share with them, you know, what makes our work so incredible, right? I mean, this is what we do is nothing less than say big tech companies are making progress, right? So we have to, in the current age, have to make and reach out to all stakeholders. I remember I was at the Forbes Global Summit that happened in Boston, and they had invited me at the time to speak about gravitational wave discovery. And it so happened that morning, Kip Ray and Barry received the Nobel Prize. So that morning was the announcement of the Nobel Prize. I was at the session and Professor Lisa Randall was hosting, and she just introduced and said that, you know, he's part of this work and his team leaders got the Nobel. And there was, in the crowd, there were only the startup person, CEOs or, you know, completely different, like no academic audience. And all of them erupted and started clapping for a solid 2 minutes. And for them, when then to explain to them, you know, what a black hole collision is, you know, how we actually go about finding a wave which is only a millionth, you know, makes a disturbance only a millionth the size of a proton. And that we have the technology now to do all that, probe halfway across the universe, a few kilometer long objects. And that just makes me so great, you know, all, you know, telling to people who are not, had not expected that this is what the civilizational knowledge is right now. So it's whether it is speaking at such events, whether it was speaking to the prime minister, the chief minister of my state, you know, if, with all of them, that is the, I think, my central excitement.
Excellent. I know that you have also been part of the delegation that met with the prime minister, right, for the signing of the MOU between NSF and DAE for LIGO India. You have also given many talks across India to promote LIGO India, including a TED talk, isn't it?
Yes, yes. That was, you know, almost, one has to pinch it. I know how incredible that feeling is. I particularly remember, so when I was on my way to meet with the Prime Minister, and, you know, you just have the sort of, you know, flashbacks, you know, like how many things in life had to go right. Going from, you know, after 12 joining BSc Physics, you know, like having this constant nudge from the society that this is not the path. And for the longest time doing something that none of your closed ones can really understand. They support you, but it's like no one really gets the seriousness of what you do. And that you get to share with the leader of your country. I think that made me, and more importantly, I was able to talk with him in Gujarati about gravitational.
Yes.
I was very happy with that.
So great to hear that. I know that you are also involved in science policy making. So this is something that, we would be very interested in, like India education and public outreach, to hear more about.
Yeah. In my PhD, we had a requirement to do a minor outside your course of study. And at the time I got this MacArthur Foundation's Semnan Fellowship. Mm-hmm. Which made me do a training for 1 year in science and education, science policies particularly, and how it correlates with international relations and security requirements. So I was very fond. It completely opened a new dimension to me as a scientist. I figured, at least, you know, partially in that training of, you know, fellowship, that funding science and doing science are very two different things.
Right.
And you have to master the other side as well, especially when we are proposing experiments that are so ambitious. So that's when it sort of started. And being here in India and visiting different stakeholders, I think I got to get more exposures. Got to be in Gujarat government's education advisory board on a startup and innovation that they had, and also part of universities in Gujarat, their advisories. So I've been very happy that of course, it doesn't really start with gravitational waves. It starts, you have to have a sort of an end goal, which is very different. Maybe it is learning big data, maybe learning programming, like that's the angle you approach. That's what I've been very much a part of. And I wrote a few papers on the big data and space policies about it.
Well, I think we can also use some of your wisdom for LIGO India outreach later.
Yeah, I mean, the advantage point being that LIGO India is already sort of such a familiar name. And in my times when I was, I gave one talk at the Ministry of Earth Sciences in New Delhi. And there were geophysicists, but they still had a level of familiarity and had, you know, asked, you know, can we study with such a sensitive instrument? Can we use that as a sort of, you know, mega seismic detector of that nature? And I was like, wow, you know, that's that's not the goal, but we have, but it is at least opening up and more horizons to collaborate. So I'd be more than happy. And of course, there is a strong US-India angle to all of gravitational wave activities. And that geo relations also make it very interesting.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. So that brings me to my next question. So you're engaged with a lot of next generation initiatives, right, for gravitational wave experiment. You already talked about LIGO India. I know that you are also involved with lunar detectors and decihertz detectors. So I don't know, recently I saw in the news about the lunar gravitational wave antenna. I don't know if you're part of that mission as well.
I stumbled upon lunar thing I hadn't thought about it, honestly. I was thinking about a decihertz detector, and European Space Agency had a call for what would be the post-LISA missions in their WISE 2050, you know, sort of mission plan. From on behalf of the LISA consortium, we had formed a task force, and I was leading a paper on white paper on what could be the decihertz science case if we were to build a LISA-like mission just for decihertz. And it sort of becomes, I mean, once you start looking at the technologies available to do that, you know, it's a very hard thing to reach between LISA and LIGO scale, because you cannot make LIGO more sensitive at low frequency beyond a certain threshold. I mean, even if you build like next generation experiment like Einstein telescope or Cosmic Explorer, and you cannot make LISA more sensitive up beyond a certain frequency, because then the photon shot noise, you know, affecting how these satellites communicate work. So the alternates were to imagine, you know, there is some in future, we are going to reach a certain technology that allows us to do that in space. I was also part of proposal with the folks from France in CNRS that you can build a CubeSat, which is accessible to decihertz. But then, so I was speaking about all this to one of my mentors, Avi Loeb. And then Avi had this, he's really this big ideas person. And his thought is, then why not build something on moon? And I was like, well, that sounds pretty crazy at first principle. But then we started exploring it, and it doesn't seem that crazy. I mean, the crazy part is, who wants to go to moon to do gravitational wave astronomy? But once you overcome that, I think the rest of the parts of the science that we get, you know, once we are on the moon is incredibly much more powerful than a lot of space missions. And that has to do with the moon's geocentric orbit. So, you know, the sky localization is incredibly improved. A binary neutron star from a moon-based detector would be there for a couple of years or that kind of a time scale. So we started with the design case, and then I submitted a few places. We submitted at NASA's Artemis couple. We submitted at SNOMAS, which is a DOE's mission. And then with with the Lunar Gravitational Wave Antenna Collaboration, we submitted one. Just we recently submitted a formal grant to a International Space Institute. So this is all activities that are sort of churning in. I think I do see that gravitational wave astronomy from moon is quite possible in our timeline, in our lifetime, let's say.
These are excellent initiatives. Actually, given the pandemic situation, I would sign up to go to the moon for this project.
Yes. So when I give colloquiums or somewhere, the colleagues make fun. So, you know, who's going to sign up to be LIGO fellows on the moon?
I would. So we already learned a lot of interesting things about you. Finally, tell us something about your hobbies. I heard that you like golfing. I can see the golf kit behind you. So tell us a little bit more about golf or music or your passion.
I enjoy playing golf quite a bit, and it's actually playing a career in physics is like golf, right? You can learn all the skills, but at that day and time, there is just so much luck that plays in. When one looks at, you know, like discoveries like gravitational waves or intermediate mass black holes, once in a century phenomena that one gets to be part of. And it's sheer luck, I think. You know, one can plan a career some in some ways. Golfing is also very meditative. Those who don't play golf find it extremely boring. So I sympathize with them, but it's very meditative. I've been playing since I was quite young. So I enjoy that. But the thing that I really enjoy most is Hindustani classical music. And I think my entire day is surrounded by, you know, different Shastriya Sangeet rags. I personally feel, and this is something not, I take it as a, you know, light con, but I think in my overall exposure as a human being, there are only two things that have blown me completely. One is Euler-Lagrange equations, and the second is understanding of how rags work.
So you don't only tune into gravitational wave frequencies, you also tune classical music. Really, yes. Nice to hear about that. One fun fact about your wedding and the connection with gravitational waves.
Yeah, it was on February 11th, which was the discovery announcement of gravitational waves. And
so I wanted to ask if this is a coincidence or did you plan this?
No, we planned it that way.
Okay.
So, because I wouldn't believe in astrology at this point of time. And there is no, murat or, you know, things like that. You know, what is the nice day, good day? It's like, if we want to celebrate a day because it has some connection with our celestial knowledge, then there is nothing better than the day we announce the discovery of gravitational waves. And my wife was a sport about it. And she's like, okay.
That applause.
My wedding invitation had all this small factoids about gravitational waves, and it was good, you know. So most people in my, you know, wedding were actually discussing among themselves, you know, is this the first one? I had the Feynman diagram there and the first discoveries they found there.
So you designed the wedding card, right?
I sat with someone who was frustrated at the end, to the point is like, is this perfect? And I was like, no, you had a picture of Crab Nebula, but you did not put image credit NASA. And he's like, oh, you got to be kidding. I was like, no, you have to do it because that is the right way to use the image.
This is really fun to hear about. Thank you so much for sharing all these fun facts about you. Before we go, one last point. What would be your message for the next generation gravitational wave science enthusiasts in India?
I mean, one thing is, and this is the wisdom words that I received from my Yoda in life, which is Abhay Ashtekar. I do gravitational waves because he convinced me at a critical point in my career that this is the way forward. And he said, you know, there's things that you have to, it's important to know, especially when you are students and scientists, early career scientists, that what all projects are going to happen in, you know, certain time frame, and what are the limitations of certain projects. So it's cool to work on string theory, but you cannot work, you know, I mean, gravitational wave astronomy is not at the stage where we are going to find tests of general relativity which are going to violate to the point where a new theory is required. That sensitivity is not there. And maybe next generation experiments would have, but you really have to understand what an experiment's limitations are. And accordingly, plan your next step. So whether it's in a source that you are interested, whether it could be intermediate mass black holes, and maybe Lisa can see, maybe it is the primordial gravitational wave background that likely none of the upcoming missions are going to see. But you really have to know what the limitations of an experiment are. And I think that level of, us working in LIGO are really fortunate that we understand that because of the wide expertise in the collaboration. But it's really important that the students also make that effort and learn about it. I think that is central.
That's a wonderful message. Thank you so much, Karan. It was an amazing pleasure to have you with us at LIGO India. I hope everybody is really happy to hear from you about all your adventures in gravitational wave science. We are really proud of you, and I hope we can host you at IUCA and at LIGO India soon. Thank you very much for being with us.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's a true honor, and we just seeing that something like, you know, LIGO India is now inspiring students across the country is just so heartwarming to see. So thank you actually for doing all the things that you guys do.
That's a great pleasure for us. So signing off here, keep listening to our podcast for many more such interesting interviews. Bye-bye.